Welcome to the debut of the Den of Iniquity podcast, hosted by me, Reverend Raul Antony. On this show, my guests and I will be examining films, books, and pop culture from a satanic perspective. And today, I'm joined by three very special guests, High Priest and Priestess Peter H. Gilmore and Peggy Nadramia, and Magistra Ruth Waytz. Thank you all for joining me today.
Well, thanks for having us.
Thanks for having us.
And what better topic to open up a podcast called The Den of Iniquity with a discussion on Blade Runner and artificial human companions and that whole idea in Satanism. Just a heads up to our audience, we will be talking spoilers. We'll be talking about the two movies, the anime and some of the short films between the movies and other related materials. So if you want to be spoiler free, I recommend bookmarking this episode and coming back to it, watching the two films, catching up on the whole mythology of it and coming back to it, because we will be talking endings, plot points, and speculating. Some things are open-ended and there's a lot of twists, so we don't want to spoil anything for anyone who hasn't seen anything yet. So just a warning for everyone. So let's start chronologically. We've all seen the original Blade Runner, right?
Oh, absolutely. Oh,
yeah. Every iteration.
Yeah, I mean, we saw them all in the theaters as they came out, all the different cuts. We'd go and see them. And we have the Blu-ray set now that has all of the cuts. So Peggy and I just recently went and watched the final cut that Ridley had done, that he feels is his definitive version. And we did that just before going to see the new film. So we wanted to be fresh.
I just watched that this week, too, after I saw the new film. I watched the so to refresh. And I have to say, I still miss that stupid voiceover. I know everybody hates it, but I miss it.
Yeah, that's a good thing to bring up. Yeah, a lot of people are critical of that first theatrical cut. I think it explains too much at the end. Peter, Peggy, what are your thoughts on the original theatrical cut?
I don't miss the voiceover.
Nobody but me does.
No,
it sounds too much like a corny noir with that. It's like Dragnet or something.
Oh, I like Dragnet.
Yeah.
Well, I like Dragnet too, but it's not Blade Runner.
Well, you know, right. It was because Blade Runner was really probably one of the first sci-fi noir films that just seemed a little too heavy-handed. That already in the atmosphere of what was going on and in the characters, you have, you know, enforcement people and hunting down sort of outsiders, and all of those aspects are typically part of a noir film. And it's shot in a way that's kind of this hyper-baroque noir, which kind of references back to Welles' Lady from Shanghai, among other things. Ooh. And that's already good enough pedigree. You don't need the heavy-handed voiceover to say, see, it's a noir, really, really, really.
Well, everybody but me knows that. I just wanted to throw it in just because I do like it.
You know, it's funny. I've only seen a clip of that ending. I haven't watched the actual theatrical cut. What else has changed in between the final cut and the theatrical cut? What was different?
Well, I remember that the original one, there was this really terrible image of the dove being thrown up into the air. But it was this terrible, it goes up into a clear blue sky, it's all happening in the middle of a rainstorm and everything. And when that, we saw that originally, everybody's like, is that like super heavy symbolism or something? Like, you know, that, because it really just seemed out of place. And so Ridley fixed that. I mean, he liked that image of the dove going up, but now it's in a rainy sky and it doesn't seem so jarring. But to me, that was like one of the like, what the hell is that kind of things.
Well, that, one thing I'm really happy is gone is that last shot of them driving off into the sunset, you know, driving off together. You know, I mean, I'm glad it ends, you know, the cut, the final cut just ends. It just, it's not them driving away, you know, the that whole thing. So, cause I did hate that. But I mean, people hated this movie when it came out and they were desperate to try to do something to make it, you know, cheerier.
That's interesting that you bring that up, because there's some discussion right now how this new film is not doing that great. For example, another film just came out this week. I think it's called Happy Death Day or something like that. It's a cheesy kind of horror version of Groundhog Day. And apparently that has blown out Blade Runner in the box office, and people are saying, well, and then they're looking back and saying, well, the original actually wasn't a great hit. It was a cult classic. It only became popular over time.
Absolutely. It's true. It's absolutely true.
Absolutely.
And the thing is, over the years, the re-releases of the various cuts were usually in art houses. I think some were, more major, larger releases, but it was always kind of, the original one didn't do very well. It was, I think, too intellectual for a lot of people, because the thing with both of these films in a lot of ways is that they're bringing up the questions of what it means to be conscious. But that's something that you have to think about and bring your own prejudices and ideas to. It's not laying it out so specifically. And they're not action films. They're very moody and slow moving. And the original one, even though there's some amazing slaughter in them and gunplay and crazy things like that. And this one too, I mean, has enough of that.
Oh yeah.
But it's there's small aspects to a much broader, slower moving canvas that you really kind of have to be patient and just absorb the reality that's being done. When the first one came out, there was a really interesting article about it in Ciné Fantastique, and they talked all about how it was made, and the whole crew was calling the sets, the models that they made, Ridleyville, because trying to create this far future Los Angeles that was this industrial wasteland with giant truncated pyramids and flames shooting off of buildings and the perpetual poison rain, that they spent so much time. And it's amazing that it was done before CG, that shows how what you could do with practical effects. And they put so much effort into that. And that was part of this. That's a character in the film. And it's that way in both films, that the setting and the atmosphere of the time is a character. And you have to be able to absorb that and flow with that, not just think of it as something that you forget about immediately and wait for somebody to come sailing in with a lightsaber to chop somebody's head off.
Yeah. Well, I have a cool story about that from Sid Mead. They kept having starting and stopping with the original. They kept having more and more delays and delays and delays. And in that time, they just kept adding shit to the set. They just that's why everything is so multi-layered and so rich that no matter where you look, you see something really that somebody put there, because they had a lot of time on their hands and they had pretty much endless time on their hands, and they just kept going and going and going, and it really shows. And I think that's lacking in the new one. My biggest complaint, I think, about the new one is how ugly it is, how ugly Los Angeles is. And the opening shot of the original, where they're coming in and you're seeing all the lights twinkle and the flames bursting, and it's quite moving. And as a person who lives in Los Angeles and loves Los Angeles, that's my lady, But I don't see any of that in the new one. And I know that's deliberate, but the ugliness is so aggressive and inelegant that it really put me off.
Huh, interesting. Yeah, I mean, I have seen that criticism from some people. Well, one, I've the same criticism of the first one is in the second one from the normie audience, which was, it was boring, it wasn't action-packed enough. But also from fans of the original have said, yeah, this one is uglier. It's just it's lacking that kind of that I guess beauty, or I don't know what exactly they want from it. I disagree with that. I mean, I like the look of it, and I think, and I know you understand that it's purposely a dystopian future. It's not supposed to be a bright future, so things going downhill. Yeah,
I'm wondering what the fuck, why is there even a Los Angeles? I mean, there's really nothing. The opening, the overhead shots of just gray. You can't even tell what that is. Is that all those bleak, desolate protein farms? What is it? What's left? And I get the point that anybody worth a shit is off world, but then why have anything there at all?
Well, they start with the title crawl and say there was a huge ecological collapse since the first film. And the thing is, that creates the protein things. They don't have anything clear. It's almost like in Interstellar, where everything's turning into a dust bowl around the planet. So it's really a totally crippled Earth at this point. So whereas in the original one, it was heading that way. It was polluted, but it's not as dead as it is now. The homeworld is much deader in this film, and I think that's why they carried it off that way. And part of it too was I really loved when you go to Vegas and see the ruins there, the giant
designed
statues.
Them.
Yeah, well, of course. Well, I mean, Sid, you know, is crucial to so many things. He's, you know, a great futurist and brilliant designer, and has had his impact on so many films. But the imagery, I love the imagery in the new film. I really felt that there was a sweep to it that was equivalent to the original, and it was just less Baroque. But I think Villeneuve needed to have his own kind of hand in that, because when you saw Arrival, there was a very stark film. And I think that kind of aesthetic of his toned down the Baroqueness of the visuals that Ridley had. But I think Deakin's cinematography is stunning in this movie, and that so many of the things he captured were really brilliant.
Mm. Well, that all the water reflective imagery and stuff in the new one was, I think, really lovely. And it was a nice, there were a lot of really nice grace notes and callbacks to the original that weren't heavy handed, which I was grateful for, including that the bird at the end, you know, that was just lovely.
Yeah. And also you get, again, the sort of the advertisements that were happening, the hologram things. And this time they're actually interactive with you, which was amazing.
I was so happy to see Pan Am and Peugeot.
Oh, yeah, and Atari.
Atari, yeah. Atari's still around. They're hanging on, apparently.
That future.
That timeline, yeah. Yeah, there's a lot of these, reoccurring themes, these symbols that connect the two films. Rain, you know, is a big thing, like tears and rain, and that's the obvious connection in the final battle scene in 2049 and the ending of the first one. There's also glass. I noticed that there's glass in glass imagery, breaking glass, shattering glass. That's a big deal in both films.
Yeah, where the and the little pod thing that's gently sliding under the waves as they're trying to get out of it, and he's fighting with her, remember, and they're sliding under the water. Mm-hmm. Any minute now, they're going to submerge.
Yeah.
Well, I wanted to talk about the difference between Rachel and Love.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah. Well,
because I thought that there was Rachel was built entirely about being a human, about humanity. And mm-hmm. Love was just this calculating killing machine. There was no humanity in her at all.
Yeah.
Well, one of the interesting things about Rachel, even going back to the novel, is that as a replicant, she was supposed to be very feminine and alluring so that she could seduce the Blade Runners and save the other replicants. That was an intention, even in the original book. And so that she had that immediate seductive ability where, you know, Ridley kind of points out that it was really meant just to get Harrison Ford, you know, the replicant instantaneously and sew that up. But in the original novel, that was her task, that she wasn't a killer at all. She was actually intentionally a constructed seductress.
Right. Well, let's have a moment on Harrison Ford as replicant or not.
Yeah. Yeah.
I know that this is hotly or not hotly debated. Is Deckard a replicant? And in the book, he is not.
He's not.
He is a human being.
Although in the sequels, they play around that Jeter wrote three sequels to it, and he tries to bridge the movie with the original novel.
Oh,
and that becomes something where they pull it together where he probably is a replicant. So it's a constantly shifting concept.
I think Ridley Scott was pretty clear that he is. I mean, they even from all of the reflective light shots in his eyes and all of that, all of Gaff's remarks. And I mean, it's pretty clear that Ridley Scott thinks he's a replicant, but I'm not sure what Philip K. Dick thought.
Well, no. And the thing is, the film, the original film is a really loose adaptation of the novel anyway.
Oh, that's for sure.
So, you know, I think Ridley left it kind of up for grabs at first. But then when he did his final cut, he's like, no, he is a replicant. That's what I'm wanting it to be. And he makes that very clear. I mean, that little leaving of the unicorn at the end.
Yeah.
That's like, okay, bingo. Yeah, answered. Done.
Not subtle. No.
Yeah.
But now, so I have a question about the whole thing about now. So are only replicants capable of being Blade Runners because they need the physical stamina, because they can't be, because normal humans would just be crushed by these replicants? Because I don't think in the beginning, when what's his name gets killed by Leon, he's a human, isn't he?
He's just somebody who's in the Tyrell building, you know, working. He's not really
He's just administering the VoIP.
Yeah, he's just an administrator. I don't think because he's not armed. He's not really set out like a Blade Runner. The Blade Runner seem to be detectives types who are out there, ex-detectives who are doing it. Like, he just seemed like an administration guy.
Right. Yeah, there's in the scene where he's rounded up to the Harrison Ford is rounded up into the police department, and he's saying, well, why don't you go get this guy to do it? He responds, well, you know, he's in intensive care right now.
Right.
So I don't know whether or not he's alluding to, you know, him being just a guy who works for Tyrell who could have been really good at this, or if he was a Blade Runner. But that would make sense if Blade Runners needed to be replicants in order to go toe-to-toe with another replicant. I mean, that would also indicate that Deckard was a Nexus 8 or not a Nexus 6, because a Nexus 6 have that, was it 3-year lifespan?
Right.
And obviously he lives a lot longer than that, so he needed to be...
Well, we don't know how long he's lived. We don't know. I think he was based on, because I have questions about why everybody hates him so much, why in both movies, why everybody's so hostile to him, to him and Ryan Gosling. They're calling skin jobs and all that, and why they hate him. And I was talking to another friend of mine, and they said he suggested that maybe Deckard was a human and was killed and was, you know, repopped as a replicant as to be a Blade Runner. Because when he says, I need the old Blade Runner back, he may be referring to Deckard as a human being.
Yeah, you know, the thing is, again, that's something that occurs elsewhere, but really not in the frame of these two films. Because in the films, the idea of replicants having full like reincarnations of human characters isn't an issue. Actually, in the sequels that Jeter wrote, it does become an issue, because Tyrell was actually hoping to create fully human replicants that he could keep putting himself into to be immortal.
Never die. Yeah.
Yeah. And what's interesting, you know, let's take a step back to this movie Creation of the Humanoids from 1960.
Well, I don't think I've seen that.
Yeah, this is a low budget.
What you want to talk about, yeah.
Yeah. This is a low budget science fiction movie, and it was released in about 62, you know, and then I think 64, the wider release, but it was shot in color. It has a fully electronic score. And the premise of it is that there had been a terrible nuclear war on Earth, and that humanity and the animals and all of that had been pretty much wiped out. The remaining humans are growing more and more infertile, and so the species is dying. So we started to create like very non-human robots to do the work, because there was not enough people to do the work that was needed even to keep folks alive. And over time, the robots, there are numbers like an R24, an R whatever. There's a whole prologue to the film that shows these very kind of tacky 1950s robots, sort of some stock footage and things. But finally, they got to a point where they created humanoids, which were robots that look like humans. And the humanoids sort of have no hair, and these metallic eyes that look like, you know, ball bearings, and they're kind of more stiff, but they're fully human in form. And the idea is that these robots are then evolving themselves to be more like actual humans. And there's scientists working with them to do that, because, in fact, the scientists know that the human species is doomed, that it will not carry on before, you know, within a generation, it'll be gone. So the robots have everybody's best interests in mind. And so the idea is that they can become fully human and be human, you know, to keep humanity going. So what happens in the film, there's a really interesting concept that the Society of Flesh and Blooders are humans who hate the robots and think that flesh and blood is important, and that they call the robots, you know, in Blade Runner, they're skin jobs. Well, in here, they're clickers. So the robots are the clickers. And the robots have to go every once in a while back to the father mother, which is a sort of hive mind computer where they have to regenerate. And it's a temple that they go to do this. Mm-hmm. But they share all of their information that they collect. Now, the guy who's the hero of this, who's sort of almost like William Shatner, it's Dan McGowan. He's this very studly guy. And he's the head of the Flesh and Blooders. And they're very almost neo-fascist. They wear uniforms. They kind of wear like sort of Civil War kepi hats. And so that's their whole thing, is to go against these clickers from having any kind of deeper connection with humanity.
Mm.
So what ultimately happens is that the lead character falls in love with this beautiful young woman. and his own sister is in rapport with a robot. The robot was kind of her companion and artificial human companion. Like, she bought him. And what they could do is sort of link their emotions so they were each emotionally bonded with one another in a sort of, you know, wedding with a non-human. But they were true artificial human companions. And so, you know, the lead character is like disgusted by this. There's like a great scene where he visits his sister and deals with the robot and even does a sort of physical assault on the robot to show that he's not fully human. And she just looks at him as like he's pathetic, that he can't accept the difference of this obvious consciousness. Very, you know, meaningful approach. But what we finally find out is that ultimately the lead character is a replicant, a clicker, and the woman that he fell in love with is one also. Because what the robots with the scientists have learned how to do is to transfer one's consciousness fully into a complete replica body. Ooh. And the very end of the film, this is discovered because the scientist had himself killed by the robot, so he couldn't give up his information. And he reincarnated himself into a younger body that was him. And so he tells the lead characters that they're both robots, and there are R96s, I think, at that point. And he says, but now the next step is I can give you the upgrades that you'll be R100s and you'll be fully fertile and able to reproduce. And the two look at each other and hold hands. And then the doctor looks into the camera and says, of course this experiment succeeded. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here.
Nice. So do you suspect that this was an influence on Philip K. Dick? And
absolutely.
Yeah. I don't think it could not have been.
Yeah.
I mean, it's so much of the concepts on every level are there. And I mean, I don't think anybody even brings this up at any point. I saw this film when I was a kid because it came on television like in the 60s and it was like in its first run on TV and I saw it.
I've seen it too. I watched everything like that. I just don't remember.
Yeah. According to IMDb, it was one of Andy Warhol's favorite movies.
Wow, that makes sense.
And, it also featured Dudley Manlove.
From Plan 9.
Who we all know from Plan 9 from Outer Space.
Oh, I love it.
Wow. Yeah, it's a really good film in so many ways. It's really low budget, and like Blade Runner, it's talky and slow moving. But it also has the same, you know, has an interesting electronic score. But the scenario is exactly the same. It really is kind of amazing.
Interesting. I'll have to dig it out.
So
there are other films similar to like Westworld, and that also had a revival with the HBO series. You know,
The HBO series was much better than the original movie, I think, although I was a kid when the movie came out. But
well, you know, the HBO is going into more the idea of artificial consciousness and how we deal with when we've invented consciousness that's independent of us. I mean, the Battlestar Galactica show, especially the revised one,
that's the same thing. I'm gonna bring up. Yeah.
Yeah. The Cylons, especially the humanoid ones, are practically indistinguishable from people. So and the great movie AI certainly goes with that, too. So,
It's a concept that goes all the way back to Pinocchio, you know, I want to be a real boy.
Right.
It's like this whole, you know, humans just have this, we have this thing. If we form something that looks like us, we immediately imbue it with, you know, the characteristics of ourselves. And, you know, after a while, we don't want to separate the two things.
Right. And, you know, the character of Data, too, from the next generation of Star Trek is another very similar aspect. You know, when Dr. LaVey talked about the artificial human companions in the Speak of the Devil, the canon of Anton LaVey movie, he was thinking that the idea of having an artificial human companion so people don't really impinge on other people, that they could have somebody that suits their needs without being bent to their will, so they're a subservient consciousness. But also what he was suggesting is that so many people are so boring and have so little to offer that if you created something artificial, it could be much more interesting to look at, much more interesting to talk to, much more interesting to spend your time with. If you spent the money and got the right model that had all the upgrades that you wanted, you could really have something a lot better than you might run into in your short time on Earth. So, but he wasn't so much thinking about consciousness as having its own rights. He was really seeing it as something that would not be independent, but something that was sort of like an appliance or a subservient aspect. And where we've gone these days, of course, you know, even thinking of things like the Terminator and such too, it's more of that kind of concept that once we create artificial intelligence and it really has self-consciousness, how do we deal with that and how should we respect it? Or, you know, should we or shouldn't we? And that seems to be, of course, the issue that all of these films are exploring.
Yeah. Well, those Japanese cartoons of our childhood, like Eighth Man
and Astro Boy.
And Astro Boy, again, the reluctant artificial human, you know, wanted so much to be real.
And had emotions.
And a soul.
And self-determination. That was always an interesting thing.
Yeah, during the my recent interview with Kotaku, one of the many topics we talked about was artificial human companions, and they asked me about that, about how do you contend with that kind of moral dilemma? Like, what if the artificial human companions are conscious, can feel that kind of can give you that kind of feedback? Because the writer was actually aware of LaVey's thoughts on it. It's like, well, LaVey was thinking like sex robots, slave robots, even, you know, to take out that kind of the vents of that kind of those kind of emotions that you don't want to impose on other people. But so there's that gray moral area there. And I responded with, you know, basically we don't know the answers yet because we haven't reached that pinnacle of technology yet. But as Satanists, we are exploring that. We are talking about it. This is part of our philosophy, part of our religion, is to contend with these ideas because it is going to be a new industry that's coming up. And LaVey was on the ground level of this. And I think a lot of us Satanists have that perspective going into the future in this kind of topic. And Peter and Peggy, what are your thoughts on that moral question? Should artificial human companions have kind of feedback, have artificial intelligence or some kind of sentience?
Well, I mean, Dr. LaVey, you know, being who he was and having a sort of darker view of humanity, he saw the role of artificial human companions as somebody to be there to receive all the negative emotions that you might express towards another human being. You know, somebody you could abuse, basically, get your frustrations out without actually harming someone else. But obviously there are other, you know, more positive aspects to the role that they play, like Marilyn Mansfield makes those babies, and those are genuinely seen as therapeutic tools. They're used in therapy, and there's positive and negative aspects to it. So as we go forward, if these things actually started to have their own sentience, it would be a difficult situation because they are only created because we wanted them to be here. But at the same time, by having sentience as human beings, we kind of, as a, you know, a race, we have kind of given that idea of intelligence this kind of overarching sacredness, that it has to be respected and has to be given, you know, the same rights. So it's not a question I'd want to tangle with.
Well, I think, you know, the philosophy of Satanism, I think, almost inherently respects consciousness and sentience.
Right.
That if there is something,
if we make something and we imbue it with sentience, then we have the obligation and responsibility to it. It's a species. It's not a toaster.
You know, right.
Battlestar Galactica, they're not toasters.
Right. Yeah. That was the insult, the toasters.
Yeah.
And exactly that. It's like once they're not just something that's responding to a program and algorithms, but it's something that's self-conscious and sentient.
Yeah, then, I don't have to worry how my Vitamix feels about the smoothie, but yeah.
Yeah, once they go beyond that, it's really something that is worthy of respect and companionship and friendship. And then it's a challenge because then we really need to also bring our aspect of negotiation. It's not, it would be seduction rather than command or abuse if they were
or
sex.
Rape.
partners, yeah, or rape. You know, these things would be something that, you again, would have their own choice and should be covered under the law and seen as equal beings. And that's
exactly what you don't want, which is this is exactly why we create these robots, is to get around that.
Yeah, well, that's what we're seeming to be doing. And that's the question that Blade Runner brings up and all these other films, that once you create things that are actually independently sentient, then all bets are off. Like, they're no longer slaves and tools. And, you know, it's sort of an interesting issue, because the Star Wars films deal with a clone army that's created to defend the Empire. And they're all beings. They're all conscious beings. They may be grown in vats and have accelerated growth patterns. And what's interesting is that the movies themselves never deal with that. And in these now sequels, they're not clones, the stormtroopers. But in the Clone Wars animated series, they actually explore the concept of these soldiers that were born to fight for the Empire actually becoming more self-conscious and dropping out of the army and saying, hey, what the hell am I doing? I don't need to die for you. Like, just because I was born and purchased doesn't mean I'm your slave to die for you. And so
that was our intention, though.
yeah. But, you know, but the thing is, what's so funny is that the Republic, who does that, you know, it's not even the Empire, it's the Republic at that point, which is supposed to be dealing with a certain amount of freedom amongst all these different kind of species throughout the galaxy. Suddenly they create a slave army, whereas the rebels, the ones who are trying to break loose, they just use robots. Like, they're fighting their war with robots. And the supposed good guys are using slaves, which is really an inherent contradiction, which nobody seems to ever think about when they go to these movies.
Wow. let's tie it back to Blade Runner, because there's an interesting angle that I may have missed it, but I don't see a lot of people talking about it, is that was he a replicant sympathizer? Like, cause he must have... He must have made Rachel capable of giving birth without telling anybody. He must have made Deckard a new model of this, a new Nexus model, right, to outlive it. So,
it takes two to make a baby. So the male model has to, you know, be made somehow fertile as well.
Which again goes back to the question of, is Harrison Ford a human being or is he a replicant? Because if he's a human being, he has viable sperm.
Right.
And if he isn't, then, you know, what is all this? Well, and this whole baby thing, I mean, I know that this is the point of the second movie, but there is one thing that brought it back up, was what I wanted to talk about, the difference between Tyrell and Wallace. Just like the differences between Rachel and Love, Tyrell, I think, is you know, he's relatable as a 21st century human businessman to us, but Wallace is, you know, this hipster guy. I was really surprised how young he was, but I saw Tyrell as more of a benevolent person, and Wallace, I think, is an asshole. His first act when we see him is he slaughters this replicant, which the birth process was pretty freaking cool, but you know, they're her, you know, coming out of her bag, but he knows she can't have a baby. So what's the whole point of that scene where...
Well, I think he was trying. I think he's trying to get them to be able to do that. And he keeps working towards it, because he said that Tyrell could do that. And after that great blackout happened and all the information went away...
Right.
Tyrell's secrets are lost. So it's like the original Dr. Frankenstein and all the subsequent Frankenstein movies. Because that's, again, the same concept. Like, we're making a being. Is it conscious? You know, so he's... you know, the secrets of life and death here, like, we, you know, they have the secret of creating some kind of life, but they don't know how to really let it make more life. Tyrell had that. But Tyrell was also, I think...
How did he know that she wasn't, when he hatched her, that she wasn't, that he should kill her right away?
I think all those, he was taking readings of her with all those floating things around him. I think that somehow he could tell, like, he has all those augments. Like, I think because he's blind, he can.
Well, that was my other question. Do you think that that was voluntary, that augment thing, or that he's blind and that was all done in response to that, or that he isn't blind and that was a choice he made to have all that augment, that he sacrificed his actual sight for that second sight?
Yeah, we don't know. And I think that's interesting. And that if there's a sequel, like, more about him should be explored. I think they'd have to. Because here's another thing, too, to remember, that Ridley Scott considers the Alien films to be in the same universe as the Blade Runner films. And when you saw the daughter played by Charlize Theron, I think she's a replicant. And I even wrote about that in my screen treatment for a sequel to that, that he's also got the David series, which are actual, you know, mechanical androids. They're not biological androids as the replicants are. And that seems to be where Ridley sees humanity going, that the idea of these biological humans gets stopped at some point, and that all that we have are the robotic humans, you know, that are clearly, like, if you x-ray them, you can see that they're half mechanical. They're cyborgs, not replicants. But I think that Wayland has got the stuff from the Terrell company and has been playing with that. So
that's interesting. Yeah. And I heard that as a rumor, but if that's, yeah, I didn't know that was confirmed. Okay. And that's interesting.
You know, Ridley Scott said it like early on before the film came out. He said, these are all in the same universe. And, these are part of it. The thing is with the new sequel that they had just done, the most recent Alien, you know, the Prometheus one really had a character that I think was a replicant, because she's too young to be the daughter of this really ancient guy, you know, in many ways. So, and she's also extremely strong because she could fight with David, who's extremely strong. So I think there were all these hints in Prometheus that she's a replicant, but since they didn't deal with her in the second film, it's like, okay, they just dropped that concept. But go back and read my treatment that you can find on, you know, where I have my writings on churchofsatan.com. You'll see how I played with that idea.
Okay. Yeah. Interesting. And then there's the, I just want to talk shortly about the Roy Batty scene while he kills Tyrell, and that the whole symbolism in that scene, the kind of deicide. And again, that ties to the new movie in terms of, you know, becoming creators, becoming gods almost in a sense, you know, by giving life. I mean, there's that theme that connects the two.
Well, an interesting thing, just a quick aside, in the Blade Runner sequels, the eyes were important for the transference of human consciousness into the new replicant bodies. So part of the thought was to spin that why he crushed his eyes in particular was to stop Tyrell from being able to reincarnate himself.
Oh,
blindness. There you go.
Yep. Yep.
Wow.
So there you. That's other aspects of it.
Huh. So how do we feel about the first film? Are we all fans of it? Or any?
Oh, absolutely.
Great criticisms of it. I mean, you never know. Yeah. And how about the second film? Are we all happy with the second film?
I was.
I'm happy with both. Yeah.
Ruth?
I thought the second one was too long, but I think everything's too long. I like Ryan Gosling as much as the next guy, but if you don't like Ryan Gosling, don't go see that fucking movie, because he's damn near every frame. And I just, obviously two different directors, two different decades, two different centuries that these movies were made. So it's,
yeah, I do. Compare. I agree that I think it's too long. I think the second film, I think there are definitely areas where they could have shaved a minute here, a minute there, and brought that down. There are some things that are just dragged out. You're just like, we know why they're fighting. Yes. We know who's going to win. The fighting's not particularly exciting. It's not a, you know, martial arts movie. Like, could we drop a minute or two here? And other places, too, where that was definitely the case. And Ryan Gosling, you know, I've been neutral about him. I call them face actors. He's always one of those young faces. That's all I know about them. But I thought I was really impressed with his work in this.
Yeah. Because, I think he was perfect for this.
Yeah.
Role.
Cause he starts out and he's, you know, he's a replicant. So he's got this kind of weirdly placid, you know, obedient expression on his face. It's like almost like a half smile most of the time. It's very placid. And then as the film goes on, you start to see emotion enter his face in very subtly and very effectively. I was really impressed by him.
Yeah, he did a terrific job. The other really strong things about the second movie, the soundtrack is it's fantastic, and it really is another character in the movie. And that's one of the things that they manipulated in all the different versions of the original. There was that one really weird, growly insecti, which I love. Mm-hmm. And this was I saw that come back in the second movie. I thought that was a real strength, and the costumes too were absolutely terrific in the second one, and of course in the first one. But it's hard because you're comparing it to something that you love, and I definitely, Blade Runner is a movie I love and have seen I could not tell you how many times, and so they had a tough deal trying to, and I wanted to like it. I went into the new one wanting to like it because I'm not the kind of person who goes to a movie expecting to hate it or wanting to hate it. I do think it was too long. I did really, it really put a bad taste in my mouth, what I said at the beginning, about the beginning, that just the aggressive ugliness that didn't telegraph a story. I think that was what it really failed me. Okay, ugliness is fine. But, it didn't really telegraph the story. I think it stumbled at the beginning and then got really good. Some of the things in the new one, the whole thing with the daughter, the designer, the stuff that she was doing, the CG work was just phenomenal. You could tell that they were taking the advantage, or taking the opportunity rather, to just show off how much we can really do in a movie right now. And it was mind blowing.
Well, even Rachel's reappearance was pretty extraordinary because, That actress is really, is exited from doing anything, and it looked like she was really there. And it was
except for the green eyes.
Yeah, well, but I mean,
yeah, the eye color is wrong.
There was the great point. Like, oops.
And his reaction to it, just like, well, yeah. Yep. Yeah, and how do we feel about one of the criticisms we're seeing online right now is sexism, is the treatment of female characters in both the films, and how
come on.
The strongest characters in the film are women.
Are women. Both
yes.
Movies.
Lieutenant Joshi and Love and what? And,
yeah,
and
having
then
the female head of the LAPD.
How many more women characters could we stuff in this film?
Exactly.
Yeah. That's exactly my point.
This podcast, so I didn't read any reviews of the new movie because I didn't want to have any kind of pollution in my head from it. But that is some bullshit.
Yeah, there's a lot of commentary on that right now from the usual kind of that side of the politics. Yeah, there's they're saying like, oh well, there's so much violence done to women. There's the way Harrison Ford character forces himself on Rachel in the first film, which is, I don't know. I mean, one can say like, well, that's the noir kind of trope, right? That's like
exactly.
The forceful man and the woman who gives in to him and the push and pull of romance. But of course, you can look at it from a feminist lens and say like, well, he, practically raped her or something like that. And that's what they say. I don't agree with that, but that's the idea out there.
The plot in the original is that Rachel is supposed to hook up with him and seduce him, like whatever, by at any means possible. Tyrell wanted that.
And she's completely flirting with him through that 100 questions thing.
Yeah.
It's
a
classic noir flirt with the cigarette and the, the lipstick.
Or a lesbian.
Yes. Come on, really.
Yeah. Please.
Yeah, I'm not buying that at all. And yeah, and in the new movie, I can never remember Sean's ex-wife. What's her name?
Oh, yeah.
Robin Wright.
Yeah, she's playing Joshi.
Right. Right, Robin Wright. She's a strong character, and Love runs the movie. I don't like her because she's mean, but she runs the movie. So.
Yeah, and there's the idea of just the use of the sex worker, right, as a puppet. I mean, that's
That scene was unbelievable when he uses her, or she uses her, or they use her to have the sexual experience.
Yeah,
that was one of the best things I think I've ever seen on film.
That was it was beautiful how they showed what they can do with that technology now, and it was totally believable and totally effective.
Yeah, oh, right. That's what I meant earlier when I said that they're just showing off because the mm-hmm. do that scene, and then the scene where with their daughter, with the daughter, all the things that she can do in that bubble. Where's her fucking toilet?
Good. Yep. We can talk plot holes, yeah.
Well, I've got a plot problem for me, but it's only personal. It's like, how dare they let him fly away and leave his dog looking at him flying away? Like, goodbye. No, I'm like, oh.
Yeah.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, I was waiting for something bad to happen to the dog.
Well, he got knocked out, sort of, but then he was still alive at the end.
The dog is just standing there, like, watching him fly away in that little ship, and you're like, no.
Well, if it's any consolation, I'm sure the dog was artificial.
Yeah, well, but you know,
afford a real dog.
He's an old dog.
Yeah, well, that's
though.
True. He probably couldn't afford a real dog, and most of the animals were dead.
The
previous film established that. But also, yeah, exactly. But the other thing too is that in the sequels, like, there's an owl that's got actually Terrell's consciousness lodged in it, like Spock's Katra and McCoy. It's the same kind of idea.
Cool.
Like, that's part of one of the plots that goes on in the sequels. But, you know, we sort of almost skipped by the fact that the replicant's artificial human companion is a holographic artificial human companion. And
yes,
finally he gets the upgrade to be able to let her materialize outside the room and then to take her with him so that she can see and experience the world. And she becomes, it seems, conscious, but then, you know, the wonderful debate about that is when he stands there and the sort of advertisement version of her is there and interrupts him. Psychics tell you, you'll see and you'll hear everything that you want to hear.
What you want to see, hear what you want to hear.
Yeah, so how much was she conscious or was he fooled? Was it like a cold reading?
That was another really gorgeous moment where, you know, the giant her pointing her finger at him, at tiny him. It was just beautiful.
But it's also, it brings that question up, like, was she just a device? Was she an appliance, or was she becoming conscious?
Right. That's the question. And the last thing she says, that when she's crushed by love, is, I love you.
But
of course, she'd have to say that, though, if she's programmed to give him what he wants.
Exactly.
So that's, because he wanted a companion, and he wanted somebody to love him and to seem conscious.
And that product is. They sold it to him, and they sold it to plenty of other people and, I guess, replicants. I don't know. Yeah. But that was a product that they sold.
Yep.
So that was, that's something that lots of people bought to have exactly that same experience with it.
Right. But so you look with the three-dimensional biological replicants, and it's much more easy to side with them as being conscious and giving them the rights and the respect. But then now we're stuck with this idea of this artificial person, which is probably where we'll be going first. Like, that will be being achieved very shortly. And suddenly, how do we deal with that? Is it going to be that? Is it going to be faked? Are we that stupid that something can fake that to us?
Yes. Yeah. Answer is yes. The short answer is yes. The answer we want is, oh, no, absolutely not. But the short answer is yes.
So it will be, again, lines and shifting sands and tears in the rain that we won't know. We won't know.
Right. Well, and an ever stepping recursive whatever, like, we make a machine to entertain us, and the machine to entertain us needs a machine to entertain it, and then and it just keeps going.
But that, for me, is the great strength of the original, of this new movie, to take it in that direction, because, of course, when the original was made, we really had no much concept about that sort of technology, and suddenly here it is.
Cell phones when the original was made. And now, I mean, and we should also bring up Her, that movie, which is another one like this, which I loved, and I think everybody liked. I think that was a pretty successful movie, but it was a lot of the questions of the artificial human companion. How much do you need, and how much do you not need, and what's real and what's not real? So,
and in the first film, this is a reading that I have of it, and I don't know if this is reflected anywhere else, but to me, it seems that Roy Batty was driven by love, it seemed like he had some kind of attraction to Zora, the other replicant.
Right.
And when he approaches Tyrell to ask, like, how can we break this life limit? It seems like he's not asking for himself, but he's asking for his companions. Like, so there's that element that, of course, like, as replicants, you want to live as much as possible, extend that lifespan, to experience life, to really get at it. But of course, there's love too, and I think there's a hint of that in Roy Batty. And of course, in the second film, the idea of Gosling's character achieving humanity by giving up his own life. You know, as Satanist, I'm not crazy about that plot line, but that seems to be the idea there, that that's what makes him more human.
Huh. Well, you know, I don't think it made him more human. I think he was recruited into the cause.
Right. Well, you know, the baddie being with Zora in the novel, the replicant, one of the replicants was kind of his wife almost. They were together. They both shared the same last name, so they were sort of companions. So I think that kind of rolled over into the first movie as an underpinning, because of course the screenwriters, like, you know, did read the novel and did work from it.
Very sentimental, I think. I mean, yes, yeah. He was a killing machine, and, you know, he was the combat model and all of that. But I believe, I was going to say, I believe Roy's birthday was February 14th, but Pris's birthday is Valentine's Day.
Mm.
So their information in the original, Pris's inception date is February 14th.
There you go. Nice symbol.
Yeah. Yeah. But I think Roy is very sentimental. He is. He does have genuine love for Zora and for Pris. When Pris dies, that when he encounters her body, and I mean, that's, you know, that's very sentimental.
I think I might be getting confused, and I think it was maybe Pris. And I forget. I get their names confused.
Pris was Daryl Hannah.
Okay.
The blonde. So, but yeah, okay. they were. But I think he wasn't unfriendly or unsympathetic to Zora and Leon. They were. You know, where's our friends?
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I think he definitely had some sort of affection for Pris.
Well, I think the whole point was that originally the concept was that the replicants had no empathy, but clearly that wasn't the case with those Nexus 6 models. They really did. And that was the tragedy of them, that they could go out and see things that were beautiful and awe-inspiring and be inspired by them. Because Batty tells you that all the things that he's seen out off-world, and that even in his brief life, he's seen things that have gone beyond so many people that have their full extended lives, you know, the normal human span, that to him it was a tragedy that this is all they had and that they wanted more.
Yeah.
And that would be lost.
And just to bring back the Pinocchio metaphor, when Pinocchio wants to become a real boy, the blue fairy tells him he can become a real boy if he is brave, if he is truthful, and if he is unselfish.
Hmm.
So, you know, Roy Batty is asking for more life for his companions. He is certainly brave because of what he's done to try to accomplish that. And he's truthful because he goes to Tyrell and tells him the truth.
Yeah, he goes right to the man.
Yeah. And to go back to Ryan Gosling's character, and has anyone seen Drive, his other film?
No.
So I recommend it, because to me, that's his character from Drive in that movie.
It kind of is. Yeah, I hadn't thought of that, but you're right. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So people know, it's a film about, well, he plays an unnamed character named the Driver, just in the script. He's just the Driver. And he's a stuntman who, at night, is a getaway driver. But over time, he, in his apartment, he falls in love with his neighbor, who ends up getting in trouble with some gangs and crime, and he starts to, he's a very detached character. Like, he's very, says very little, but he starts to develop affection for her and her kid, and tries to get them out of trouble as, you know, the rest of the movie unfolds. But that is a, you know, he plays a detached character, a kind of anti-hero, who grows to,
yeah
the elevator scene is one of my favorite scenes in all of all movies. So
Here's another quick thing. This had come up in mind about, we're talking about the sexism issue. The first replicant that is retired is, you know, played by, you know, Bautista, who's this, you know, hyper masculine, you know, large muscled guy, you know, Drax the Destroyer and the Guardians of the Galaxy stuff. And I mean, here he's just sort of a humble aging farmer, but he still is massive, powerful guy. But the prequel film that they made with him is, it shows that as a loose replicant, he was, had compassion and helped people. It's definitely worth seeing that. So when you finally realize that he's coming to kill him, he's this farmer, but he's a compassionate guy, that even though he's this, you know, again, super masculine type, he's not in any way like pushing himself over on anybody. In fact, the characters he tries to rescue in the prequel are, you know, a young woman and he was defending, you know, the idea of hiding the idea of the child. You know, Rachel had her kid. She was being defended. So he's you know, maybe that's too sexist. You know, he's the protective male. But he wasn't an aggressive anti-female male. He was a male who tried to use the strength that he naturally had. However natural a replicant is. but to use it for protection. And he was protecting female characters.
Yeah. I don't see that sexism thing at all. I mean,
crap. It's crap. I mean, the leader of the resistance is an older woman.
Exactly.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
I was going to too. The old one eye. You know, she's there's lots of strong women. The women are running this movie in every way, because you notice or you don't that there's no boy joy. I didn't see any male version of that. The hologram is just female. So it's all, is that sexist? I don't know. But the holograms are, the hologram is female. The super replicant love is female. The police chief is female. The save your child is female. Come on.
Yes.
Yeah, well, actually, you know, to be more LGBTQ friendly, they probably should have had holographic, you know, male figures and companions and such, you know, that they might have gone that way to you know, make it more updated.
Women want a companion, and they're not lesbians. Come on, they should have a full range of products available.
That could have been, who knows, maybe they cut some of that, you know, like to keep it more in line with the original, but that would have certainly been something interesting to throw in.
I think it's clear we can pretty much dismiss that sexism claim, because I think that's
yeah. And Kay's boss, the police chief, there is, I think, a hint of that she may have been using him for sex too. I think there's a scene where he's in her place, and there's like a little hint of, like, you know, she may be using him for a little more.
Yeah,
and he's,
I think,
like,
you're
saying,
right.
I got a whiff of that too.
Yeah.
Well, whatever.
Yeah.
He's a robot.
Yeah.
He has no rights.
Well, remember Gigolo Joe, played by Jude Law in AI. Like, he was an artificial human companion, you know.
And his name was Joe.
I hated that when she named him Joe. I was like, no, anything but Joe. Jesus Christ. But yeah, give me some Jude Law. Yes. You have it delivered? Yes.
All right, Ruth, that's what we'll have to have them work on for
yes,
you.
Yes, get me Jude Law.
And we briefly mentioned it, but there's I think three shorts that were released in the lead up to the film to fill in the gaps between. Yeah, same here. I only saw the blackout one, and I think there was another one that was about the corporation and the development of the androids, and then a third one, which I don't remember. So I don't know what that one's about. Which one have you seen,
Peter? I want to know what the fuck about Wallace, though, because he's so unsavory and so yuck. I just, yeah, I don't know. And so young. So.
Yeah, one of them is about Wallace, I believe. Yeah.
Yeah, the one I saw was not an animated one. It was live action.
And okay.
Yeah, so it was the pre-story about the farmer character at the beginning.
Oh, right.
Okay. Right. Okay, interesting. Yeah, there's okay, I got it here. The 2036 Nexus Dawn. That one is about Wallace. And pointing out that trying to convince a panel to continue development of Nexus replicants, right? Because after
the blackout, legal.
Right. And then there's that the animated short talk covers the blackout event, which is a rebellion of the replicants that led to the launch of an EMP over Los Angeles that wiped out the records.
That's right. Nice. Yeah.
That's the one that you saw, Ruth?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. And of course, there's a lot of callbacks in that. There's a dove in that one, the shattering glass. So, I highly recommend it for anyone to watch, to get more of that universe and to understand the blackout event, which is actually talked about in the second film.
Pretty significant. The fact that it isn't really covered in the movie, I know it's already too long, but you know, there are some things that maybe a sentence here or there might have helped, because I think it's kind of shitty that in order to understand your movie, I have to see the animated short to make it somebody else first.
Well, it was in the opening crawl. They did explain that, and then they talked about it here and there, which I didn't see that short, and I got it. So.
Okay, that's cool.
Well, did you know that David Bowie was the first choice to play Wallace?
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, he was. He was the director's first choice to play Wallace, and unfortunately for us all, he didn't survive to, to be there when they started making the movie.
Yeah.
Imagine that.
Wallace, yeah, that would have been so good. But the cast of Wallace really bugged me, I think because he was so young to have accomplished so much, which, I mean, I know that the young kids are doing things these days, and that the innovation is with the youth. But I think that for somebody to have gotten to have a corporation like that and to have, I just think he was too young.
Well, you know, it's like Zuckerberg and Facebook. You know, we've got these you know, billionaires who were very young, and the idea was that he got the money and then bought all the Terrell stuff. Like, he didn't create any of it. He just bought the whole thing. So who knows where his finances came
from. He's just some rich.
Oh, because he solved, well, it explains it in the plot synopsis.
Oh, I forgot.
He got all his money from solving the world hunger problem.
Oh, that's right.
Mm-hmm. That's right. I remember now. Yeah.
Sort of Damien Thorne-esque.
That. Yes, that's right.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
If you remember the Final Omen film, that was what Thorn Enterprises was doing.
Yep. That's right. Oh, wow.
Yeah. And I have seen that connection, like as Wallace is like a devil character.
He's definitely good. He is definitely not benevolent. And maybe I'm just reading into that, but whereas I think Tyrell was a benevolent character, he was just a capitalist.
Here's the thought, though. Anybody who's creating slaves is not a benevolent character. Tyrell created slaves so that people didn't have to do the dangerous off-world work. And this guy stated right out that the only way humanity advances is through slave labor. It's on the back of those who are enslaved. And since slavery had been outlawed, you know, essentially he had to create slaves for humanity to progress. So he wants humanity to progress as it has always done throughout most of its history.
Wow. Yeah, they're neither good or bad. Yeah. What else can we talk about with the new film? Well, the score, obviously. Is it the same composers or
No. Vangelis. Well, Vangelis did the original score. He was really a pioneering electronic composer, sort of around the same time as like Tomita was doing his things and Wendy Carlos. Mm-hmm. And so he was one of the leading voices. He had done Chariots of Fire and lots of other things he was getting a lot of attention for. And so when they used him for this, he was really just the right thing, and he stepped up for it. So originally, they were going to have Johan Johansson score the film, because he's the guy who works with Villeneuve, did the Arrival score. But Villeneuve decided that he wanted something really much more of a throwback to what Vangelis did, so he got Hans Zimmer and his colleague Wolfisch to work with him.
Pretty recently, too.
Yeah.
August. In August...
Interesting.
Johan Johansson was still on the books to do this. So
that was
some amazing score to come up with in a couple of months.
Yeah. They did it quickly. But, but that was the thing, is like Villeneuve decided that it really has to be much more Vangelis-y to really blend the two together, because that's so much a part of the environment. And so his usual composer he's got too much of his own stamp on things. It was not quite... he didn't really twist himself back into the Vangelis mold. And we know that Hans Zimmer is usually very much of a chameleon. He can do very many different kinds of styles. And with the guy he worked with, they really kind of brought it really right back to that.
Mm. Yeah, the loud, the kind of overtone. Yeah, that loud.
Our theater was shaking. Like when we were in there, those huge ultra bass poundings were going on. Like literally fixtures in the theater were rattling from those.
Wow, that's pretty cool.
And did we all see it in IMAX?
No, we just saw regular and no 3D, thank you.
I thought regular and no 3D, too. I really dislike 3D. I didn't see it in IMAX. I saw it at the Arclight, though, which is the premier theater in Hollywood. It's the Cinerama Dome. I guess I could have gone to see it in IMAX, but I didn't, because I saw it kind of on a whim. It opened on a Thursday, and I had been having dinner on that Thursday with a friend, and the two of us were talking about, oh, I wish I could go see it tomorrow, when it opens, but I have plans. And he said, no, it opens tonight. And I said, what? Why are we sitting here? And so at the table, we bought our tickets. So we went from of course, to the Arclight, which is about a mile away at the most, and saw it there. So I would like to see it in IMAX. I would definitely like to see it again. I would try for IMAX, but I dislike 3D.
No 3D.
And it's funny because I saw what was that Cumberbatch movie? Doctor Strange. And I dislike the comic book movie, but Doctor Strange was totally so far up my alley, I had to go see it. And I went and saw it in regular, and I loved it. And I thought, okay, this is something worth seeing in 3D. And I went and saw it again in 3D, and I thought I liked it better in regular.
And Peter Peggy, do you guys watch any 3D films or no?
Well,
nope.
My favorite 3D film is still The Creature from the Black Lagoon. I think that really works beautifully.
And mine is One More Time with Feeling.
But also, I really liked Hugo in 3D. Because part of the way that was used, like the sensibility was all about Méliès. And the idea that cinema was fooling people, like they didn't know how real it was, that it seemed so real. So the way he shot that film was to try to give you in 3D that same kind of sensibility that people would have felt when they saw a film for the first time. So when you see it like that, because his use of 3D is really brilliant. It gives you like vertigo sense and all kinds of space and all that. It's not just meant to be like, wooga, something's flying in your face kind of crap.
Dr. Kong's 3D House of Stewardesses.
Exactly. or Jaws 3D or all that kind of shit.
I would say that the other 3D movie I really enjoyed was Coraline, that Neil Gaiman movie. Mm-hmm. That I saw a premiere of that, and I didn't know anything about the story or whatever. A friend of mine got me in. But so I went, and I had no expectations at all, and it was lovely, and the 3D was masterful. So it can work. It's not something that, oh boy, I wish they made that in 3D. No, you'll never hear me.
No, but you know what the problem is? Almost all of these movies in 3D are 3D conversions of 2D footage. Very few of these films are actually shot with two different cameras lined up to give you actually two different tracks of film. So the creature was shot that way. And Hugo was shot that way, I think, pretty much.
Nick Cage movie was, too. They shot it deliberately 3D, and it's so successful.
Yeah. But the converted ones, I don't think work so well. I think they fall down. There's enough of them, parts of it that really fall down that you sit there going, these aren't framed right for 3D. And I think somebody was talking about that. I can't even recall who was saying it, but when you shoot for 3D, you have to think of a cubic space you're moving in, not like something in a proscenium arch. So many conversion 3Ds are still stuck in a proscenium arch and don't work that way. And I think that's why they fail. It's not only the problems with the technique that it's dimming the image a lot, but it's just not conceived in a way cinematographically that functions properly as a 3D experience.
Fair enough.
Yeah, and was Dr. LaVey a fan of the first Blade Runner? Did he watch it?
Oh, he's on the film list.
Yeah, it's definitely. Yeah. He liked it.
And what were his thoughts on the kind of the replicant question and all that?
What did he say to you, Ruth?
Well, I don't really remember specifically what his thoughts were about the replicant, the answer to that question. I just remember that we discussed it and that we how much we loved the aesthetic of it and how it was how it captured all of what we loved about the noir, but the past and the future at the same time, and that it was about the mood of it. But we talked about the ethics of it. I don't remember what we did.
Well, I think for Doctor that things could be forever noir is something that struck his fancy, because it's not something that was limited back to the time period of the original film noir, but there could be contemporary noirs and future noirs. And he always felt that aesthetic was really one of the most truthful depictions of the way man's situation in the universe is. So when you add in the idea that there are these artificial humans who could be companions or used as companions or slaves, that was just another one of his issues that he was fascinated with. The Westworld film did that. So for him, like those aspects being played together in a movie definitely would always get his attention. And I think, too, for him, that he would consider, again, the ethics of real consciousness as being something that need to be explored.
Oh, totally.
Yeah. And I think, how do we see the second film as a satanic film? I mean, there's the different obvious questions of artificial human companions, the total environment of the neo-noir, and also the living of life to the fullest. I consider it a satanic film, obviously, as well as the first one. Would we add that to an upcoming film list?
Oh, absolutely. Well, I mean, the original one's there, and I would include this, because the concept, again, is what does your life mean to you, and how do you get the most out of it? You have to make that decision, and that's always the important thing about Satanism, that it puts the onus on you. And the farmer replicant had found a way of doing things that matter, that fulfilled his own values. And when he was killed, he was regretting losing the life that he had built for himself, which wasn't as a slave, but as a free man who was doing what he willed, regardless of how long the time would be. And you know, it goes back to Batty in the original and the rest of the replicants that were loose on Earth. They wanted to live as fully as possible. They wanted to have more than they were allotted because it was so paltry. And again, that's also, you know, when we look at the active applications for members of the Church of Satan, when we ask them, like, what are your three wishes? And one of the most common wishes is to live as long as one could possibly live, so long as health and faculties are intact.
As long as I'm running the show.
Yeah.
As long as I'm, you know, running the show. And I can make my own decisions about my own life.
Right. You don't want to be like a head in a jar like in Futurama.
Right.
But, you know, the idea that you want more, that like whatever amount you have, you enjoy life and you enjoy to the fullest and you want more. And that passion for that existed in both of these films. So that's certainly a satanic message.
And that you get to decide what that is.
Exactly.
Not anyone else. The nature of your life.
Yeah, the self-determination is really a real major point for these characters. You know, even the artificial AI that was a hologram, she seemed to be wanting to determine, you know, she tells him, say, you know, I'm willing to go into the mobile emitter. Like, I'm making this choice because this can enhance my life. Like, knowing that it's now more fragile than ever before. And so even self-determination goes into something that we're not even sure if it's just an appliance or not. You know, was she taking that from him, that as a replicant he wanted more, and then she was reflecting it back at him? That's a fascinating way of explaining
it. He bought her the present of the emitter. Was it a gift for her or a gift for him?
Right, kind of both, of course.
Yeah, definitely.
So that equivocalness is interesting in the way that the film goes. It's always this wonderful fount for conversation and pondering. And these will be issues that we're going to have to deal with as time goes by, as these technologies are evolved.
Yeah.
And in the animated short Blackout, there's a scene where the hero replicant Iggy is with the looks like maybe the sex replicant. They're driving away in the truck and going towards their ambush, and the girl replicant says, is there a heaven for replicants, or do replicants go to heaven? And Iggy says, no heaven or hell for us, this world is all we got.
Right. So really ding ding in my head when I watched it.
Yep.
Well, there you go.
That says it all.
Yep, says it all. Yep, ding, ding.
Well, and see, that's something that I would like to see explored in further ones, where the idea that humans have deluded themselves into thinking there's these other things, and they're missing the fact that each moment is precious. The replicants know that.
Right. Well, that's the thing I was going to say about Blatty, you know, and his plea, you know, Batty.
Batty.
Sorry. He's asking for more. Do you know what it's like to know that you have so little time? But that's not unique to replicants.
Certainly not.
Right.
Human beings have that hanging over them. What's the reason human beings are always screwing everything up is that they keep forgetting it.
Or they think they can control it, or that, you know, it's not now. It's, you know, it's way off in the future because you don't know the precise. I mean, the thing, the replicants know the precise moment of their death. We don't get that.
Right. Right.
Well, the Nexus 6, I think Nexus 8s are
they're open ended. Yeah.
Right. They
open ended. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So do you think one of the things I loved about this, about 2049 too, is that it's a complete film. It has a complete arc. It tells a story, and it doesn't try to set up a new universe, though it can, like a whole new kind of franchise. But I don't see that really as being an important part of that film. I don't mind the length of it. I'm happy with that.
I agree. But I like long films. I like the full cut of Peter Jackson's King Kong. I adore that movie. I absolutely adore that movie.
I like plenty of long movies. I liked Magnolia, for God's sakes.
Oh, yeah.
But if a movie is too long in my head, it's because shit could have been cut out for me.
Yeah,
and I can see it. But I guess what I'm trying to get at is that I think it does tell a complete story, and I think a lot of films nowadays they try to set up a franchise. They try to set up, you know, that cliffhanger ending, you know, to get you in.
Movie would work if you hadn't seen the original.
That's a good question. I think you would lose some things from it. I mean, my wife, I think she saw the original a long, long time ago, and she was not getting some things, so I had to fill her in after.
I need to see the original to get it.
Yeah, I think there's definitely a richness to the plot that you were missing if you haven't watched the first one. But I think you could still follow a storyline in it. I think it could stand alone, but I think you'd enjoy a lot more if you, you know, you have that background of the first Blade Runner.
Well, also, with Kay thinking, he's having been misled to think that he was Rachel's son.
Oh, yeah.
And thus Harrison Ford's son.
And
that added this amazing tragedy to the film. And if you really didn't know the previous characters, to really feel what they went through, and then to see him kind of come to the realization that maybe he wasn't just created, but he was born, and that he has a mother and father, and that's why he wants to know about Rachel, and that's why he wants to meet Harrison Ford. And then the pain when he finds out
that he's not.
That's not true.
Yeah.
That the memory was real, but it wasn't his memory.
Yeah.
Well, horrible, that moment.
when he first thinks that he is the baby, that was born. He's enraged. I mean, he roars with anger. And then when the lady informs him much later on that, no, the baby was a girl and it's not you. Did you think it was you? Oh, we all hoped it was one of us, but it wasn't. Then he's completely crushed. So his emotional pendulum is quite vast in this movie, that the swing that it takes, like he doesn't want to hear that he's the baby. Then he does desperately want to believe that he is the baby.
Mm-hmm. Well, and that's what drives him to really do the investigation.
Well, yeah, that's his motivation.
Yeah, I mean, that's like he's fired up to do that. And suddenly it's becomes this identity search.
Well, and let's ask about the real baby. I can't remember what her name is. The software designer. What the fuck's wrong with her?
Maybe nothing.
Yeah.
They're keeping her in the bubble for no reason?
To keep her in the bubble. To keep her away. To keep her safe.
Yeah, well, because the idea of manufacturing the thought that she had some kind of immunocompromisation that she had to be kept away may have been invented so that she couldn't be analyzed and found, you know, to be the thing that they're looking for. That if she's automatically isolated and she's also doing something that's useful and sought after, then it's like they just look past what she could actually be.
Plain sight, I guess, because she's right on her damn nose and she's working for them.
Yep. So I think that's really part of the plan. Not that, because that may be completely bogus. And I think if there's ever a sequel to this, then, you know, they will explore those things further.
There's a lot. I think, you know, it does stand alone, but there's lots of opportunities for interesting sequels on different aspects of it.
Yeah, to say it's not going anywhere. I mean, the whole point of it is it's setting up it is a setup, and it has to go somewhere because they establish that there is this child, and that is it unique? Is it the only replicate child? It's supposedly, but maybe not.
Maybe not.
Well, that's the whole thing. It's like we don't know how many of them Terrell made.
That's
that
right.
Those were the two. Yeah, we saw it through the eyes of the two that he made, but there may have been others, and they may be off-world somewhere. That's the other thing, that we've never gone off-world in either of these films, so that's a whole other aspect.
I've seen what the off-world is. Well, it's aliens.
Well, and the thing is, again, as Ridley has said, it's the same universe as Alien, so that's further in the future from where we are. Like, how do you get from here to there to the androids that we have, like David, like, and the others, Ash and all of them, like, where do we go to that? How does that happen? Like, does Ridley want that story to be told? Will that be something he requires that gets worked into the tale to be told if there are sequels to come forward?
Are they working on subsequent films? Do we know?
Well, I know there are more. He's working on more Alien films. He has at least one or two more to do. And, you know, Ridley's not getting any younger.
That's true.
For a man his age, he is really a workaholic and has a tremendous output. And I think that's also why he stepped back from directing this and got Villeneuve to do it, because it's the work on it is so difficult and overseeing and consuming.
That must have been intense.
That finding a younger man with a very great passion for this to take it, who would live up to the challenge, was something that I think was a wise decision.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it definitely was a challenge. I mean, there were a huge audience of people with high expectations and a lot of demands.
It didn't reach everybody there. You know, there's a lot of people who weren't thrilled with it. So,
but you know, like we said at the beginning of this thing, Blade Runner, the original, was a flop. It was totally unsuccessful when it first came out. So.
Yeah.
I don't really care about box office because I didn't make this movie. I don't make money. I don't care if it makes money or it doesn't. But I wanted it to be good. I really did, and I think it is good. And I will see it again. And I think that they did a good job.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it worked as a good extension of the original. That it was an interesting resolution for the characters and bringing things forward to, again, a different world with a different palette, a different director. Things have changed since the original. And I think having a different vision handle it made good sense. And I think it's a satisfying sequel. I was really afraid that something would have been really off base or really stupid or just badly imitative.
Well, no sequels suck so hard that it's so, I mean, I avoid them completely. So sequels and prequels and remakes, I never see any of that shit because it's all terrible. But this, I would not be opposed to, hey, there's a double feature of the original and this. I mean, provided there's, you know, a decent amount of time to like eat food and go to the bathroom and take a nap between. But I would see a double feature of these two movies.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, I'll be doing it at home once I get the Blu-ray of the new one.
I'll be right over.
All right, with that, I think we're about wrapping it up. Do we have any closing thoughts on the film or any other films that we might want to kind of throw out in there that might be related to it?
I actually had one other thing about this that I just read a book called Never Let Me Go by the guy who wrote Remains of the Day, which is something that I would never even go near. It's a name I can't pronounce, and I'm sorry. And the book's in the other room. But they did make a movie out of it, which stinks. It's on Netflix. It's basically they took every 10th word in the book and made it into a movie. They completely gutted it, but it's about the same thing. And since the book came out in 2006, I don't have to worry about spoilers, but it's basically about cloning instead of replicants. They've decided that they're going to cure disease, and it happens in the 1950s. They cure disease by basically growing clones of human beings. They basically farm them, and so they create these children, and they raise them in schools, and they teach them art and poetry and all these things. And the book is, and then they grow up and they donate their organs. And they go through a first or second or whatever donation until they complete. And the basically the subject matter of the book is this ethical? They're human beings. Are they?
Right.
Well, there's an old science fiction novel that deals with that.
Yeah, I was going to bring that up. I was going to bring up the concept of clones because it's a similar thing.
Yeah.
It's an,
this book. I read it in two days. Yeah. Read and
oh, I'm gonna get it.
Retracted. Yeah. Never Let Me Go.
Well, there's like an Eastern European science fiction writer who wrote a book in like the 30s or 40s that was really about cloning people, and all the clones were basically just used to have their organs harvested, and they were considered second class citizens, and just simply they lived, but you'd go there to see them, and some were missing eyes or lungs or hips or spines, and so it's an old concept that people keep going with.
And of course, it's unethical.
Yes, of course.
they mean well. I mean, we're going to clone these things. And it leads into how ethical is any of this, you know, this cloning. So,
So the idea of cloning is they should be able to clone the liver. They should be able to clone your organ. Right.
Yes.
Exactly.
Yes. Clone
Not
me
clone
liver.
Another you with an extra liver.
Exactly. Or just have that they have, you know, these schools full of these children, and then when they got to a certain age, they would just move on to these centers where they would basically just hang out and wait to be called up for their donations.
Yeah.
And the book is so nicely written, though. I definitely recommend it. And boy, the movie is terrible, so don't even.
Well, I think that, you know, for the listeners to this who are like the idea, are intrigued by artificial intelligence and the ethics around it, they really should see, you know, other movies like AI, which was the Spielberg made this film based on a script.
Yeah, I like that.
Kubrick.
I like it.
That's a brilliant and really, you know, dark movie. And also to go back and find Creation of the Humanoids, which is cheesy science fiction from 1960, but really so far ahead of its time in the concepts that are being wielded, even if they're clumsily done, the concepts are there. And it's interesting to see that as kind of an inspirational template for Dick's novel and the original Blade Runner movie.
Yeah, well, it's interesting that it is a recurring theme and that we still can't figure it out.
Well, playing God is, you know, Frankenstein, Pinocchio, all these things.
All of it.
It's everything. It's like one of the fundamental concepts and tropes in all of human exploration.
Yep. And we're still not learning.
You have to get better at being gods.
And that's what we're here to do as Satanists.
Yeah, we are our own gods, and we will be the best gods we can possibly be.
Yep, that is for sure.
With that, thank you all for joining me, and I look forward to having all of you on again to talk about anything else in pop culture, films, or anything we can think of that we can deconstruct from our perspective.
Excellent. It's a delight. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Yes, thank you, Raul.